I'm Yulin Hswen, Associate Editor of JAMA and JAMA Plus AI, and you're listening to JAMA Plus AI Conversations. My guest today is Dr. Casey Lyon, who is an Associate Professor of Pediatrics at the University of Washington School of Medicine and the Research Director at the Center of Diversity and Health Equity and an investigator at Seattle Children's Research Institute. She is also a member of the American Academy of Pediatrics, the Academic Pediatric Association, and the American Pediatric Society. Welcome, Dr. Lyon.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here.
So, as a pediatrician, you frequently highlighted the challenges faced by patients, for instance, with limited English proficiency. In particular, do you recall the first moment when you encountered those types of language barriers in care, and what led you to your realization of this impact on patient outcomes?
Yeah, I really became aware of and motivated to address the really different level of care that we provide to patients and families who use a language other than English for care during my residency training. So I remember as an intern, so in my first year of residency, we were taking care of a little boy, 7 or 8 years old, who was hospitalized for treatment of an infection, and his family was all Spanish speaking. And he wasn't my primary patient, but he was on my team. So we were rounding with him every single day. And mostly we were not using professional interpreters, even though we had access to them. Team members were mostly communicating directly in non-proficient Spanish, and it was really clear that the family was not having the same opportunity to discuss their concerns and new symptoms, even when he wasn't getting better, that English-speaking families were getting from us. And he ended up having a secondary infection, a brain abscess, that was delayed in diagnosis. And it was very clear that the language barriers with the family led to that delayed diagnosis, and it impacted his eventual recovery in significant and permanent ways. And that experience really brought home for me the very different standard of care that we provide. And even at that time, we knew that professional interpreters improved outcomes and mitigated disparities, and we had access to them, and yet we were not using them routinely, which prompted both sort of an intellectual curiosity of why is that, and what will it take to get us to do the right thing when we have access and we know it's the right thing, and a deep desire, a deep drive to really try to spend my professional time, resources, and privilege in partnering with clinicians and families to try to address this problem.
What do you think has caused this shift in people being more receiving of having communication, you know, be more fluid and to be more in depth, even across these different language barriers, for instance?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think there are a number of factors at play. I think in general, there is an increasing awareness in medicine of the importance of communication and the clear association between high quality communication and better patient outcomes. So I think over the years that there's this growing awareness that, oh, communication is really important to things beyond just patient satisfaction, right? It has been found again and again to be associated with things like blood pressure control in patients with hypertension and blood sugar control in patients with diabetes and functional status and in-hospital opioid use in hospitalized patients with pain. So there are lots of harder outcomes that are associated with communication. And so I think in general, there is more openness to the idea that, oh, this is actually a really important part of what we do as clinicians, and we should be thinking really critically about how we do it. I think the other thing that has happened more recently in the past few years are two things. One was the murder of George Floyd in 2020, which I think really opened up space for people to recognize racism and the incredible impact that it has on people's daily lives and the access to care. So that, I think, opened a lot of discussions around racism and discrimination and inequity in society in general. And then the stark disparities we saw in access to care and outcomes during the COVID-19 pandemic, I think also really opened up discussions around equity and access within care. And I think in particular, as people started thinking, I think it allowed people to be more open to the idea that, oh my gosh, we have a system of care that does not work well for everyone. And in fact, systematically advantages some populations and disadvantages other populations, and prompted people to start thinking, what can we do about that? And I think language is actually a really appealing space when people start thinking in that direction, because we actually have interventions that we know work, right? Professional interpreters, we know, improve outcomes and mitigate disparities. And so when people are looking for ways to address inequities in the care system that they work in, language is a great one because we have interventions that work. And I think it's really easy to identify where and how the disparities are happening. Racial bias is hard, right? It's everywhere and it's much harder to intervene on. We need to do it, but it's a long road. And I think language, the disparities in the way we provide care are so obvious that it's a little bit easier, I think, for people to understand, oh, this is not equitable. People don't have access. People are not getting the same level of care. So I think it's a little bit easier of an entry point for people to think about, okay, what can we actually do about this? And we have proven evidence-based interventions that people can actually start implementing immediately. So I think those things together have really shifted the discussion and people's openness to talking about it and their willingness to put personal and institutional time and effort into addressing the problem.
How do you think that AI can actually help with that in terms of the communication and even the translation?
Yeah, I think there are a couple of different really interesting and potentially exciting use cases to think about AI for addressing language barriers. And I think it's useful to think about them really intentionally and separately because the context and the potential and challenges are different in those different use cases. So I think one space is with spoken communication, so sort of voice to voice, which usually has a written translation step in it, but trying to use AI to facilitate real-time communication, conversation. And then I think the other sort of big bucket use case is for written translation. When we're thinking about that spoken communication, right, that's really the realm of where we would use a professional interpreter, with interpretation being spoken or signed communication and translation being for written communication. It's a much trickier space to try to bring AI into, I think, for two reasons. Number one, we actually have an intervention that works great in that space, which is a human interpreter. And there is so much that happens in those spoken conversations that is body language, that is context, that is euphemism and slang and cultural nuance that maybe someday AI will be there. And I just think right now it is not. And we do actually have pretty good access to human interpreters for those spoken communication. The place in spoken communication where we have a real need, where there's a real gap, is for languages of lesser diffusion. So for some of these less common languages where it is in fact really hard to get an interpreter when you need it, right? Whether that is over the telephone or video or in person, that's a space where if we actually had AI models that worked well in those languages, that could be a game changer, right? So these are languages in which there are a very small pool of certified medical translators available anywhere. So I'm thinking about things like Chukchis and Marshallese from the Pacific Islands, a number of indigenous languages from Mexico, Central and South America. There are some languages where it is legitimately hard to get an interpreter. Often people say it's hard to get an interpreter, and what they mean is it's inconvenient, and that's not the same. So I think those languages of lesser diffusion is a huge area of opportunity. And the difficulty is that the language models tend not to work well in those languages because there is not very much source material for them to have trained on, right? So we see this both in my own work and in other studies that we've looked at, that the performance of translation models tends to be best in Spanish, for example. And the quality really falls off as you get into languages for which there's less high quality translated material available online for training the models. In some of these less common languages, when you sort of survey what's available online, the translated material that's online are not high quality translations. They're sort of not very good machine translations. And so these models are getting trained on bad translations in some of these languages, which just means they perform quite poorly. So there's this real opportunity, and I think it's going to take a lot of concerted effort and thought for people to figure out how to optimize in that space rather than the much easier space, which is Spanish. So that's spoken. For written, I think it's a little bit of a different, the use cases are also really important and maybe a little bit more likely to be helpful and successful in the shorter term. So for written communication, for translation, this would be for things like patient portal messaging between patient and provider, and being able to provide real-time personalized discharge instructions after an ED visit or after a hospital stay or after a clinic visit. Right now, translation turnaround time, so written translation turnaround time, is usually hours to days. Because translation typically involves multiple people, it's a different training and certification compared to interpreters, and it's a different skill from interpreting sort of real-time, real-life conversation. And so finding ways to try to use AI to address that area of opportunity, I think, is really important. That's where my team is focused right now, because these turnaround times mean that patients aren't getting written instructions in their language that they can refer back to, or they're getting it, you know, 5 or 6 days after leaving the hospital, at which point the information may or may not be relevant anymore. Those are the places I think that we're most likely to be able to make a really big impact.
I've tried to do translation for more rare languages, and even AI, you know, Translate doesn't even have that available because I think of the limited information being inputted. You were talking about what your team is researching in this area. So tell me what you are currently working on and what you would like your outcome to be.
We are currently in the process of testing an AI language translation system. And right now we're taking it through formal testing, not as part of patient care, but we're using actual patient care documents to do the testing. So rather than using sort of standardized discharge instructions or things where there's been attention to making sure that the text is really clear and understandable in English and accessible in English, we're using the things we actually give to patients, which are often not fully understandable, right? They're things that are typed by clinicians who are in a hurry. There may be typos. Sometimes they include abbreviations or medical jargon, likely not recognizing it as medical jargon. And so in this study, we really want to understand how it performs under real-world conditions, because those are the conditions we would be using it in. And so what we've been doing is we have taken patient discharge instructions. We've translated them using professional translators and using this AI-based translation system. And we are then having them scored by professional translators who are blinded to who did the translation. And we're then comparing those scores. And the scoring is looking at the translation fluency, adequacy, meaning, and error severity, each on a 5-point Likert scale. This is an approach that's been used in a number of previous translation studies, which will then also allow us to be able to compare our results to the results that others have found in under different contexts. And so we're using our 4 top non-English languages at Seattle Children's for written instructions, which are Spanish, Somali, Vietnamese, and simplified Chinese. And then looking at the differences in performance across the different languages. We've also been surveying parents to get their input on the idea of receiving AI-based translations and how they would prioritize getting an AI translation that may need correction in the next 24 hours, right? So we'll always have a human in the loop in some way, but it may not be immediate, versus waiting a few days to get the translation and know it's already been reviewed by a human. And we're still very much in the process of gathering data, but so far we've actually been a bit surprised. Parents seem pretty split. As a clinician, I assume people want the information right now. They want it now. They want to walk out with it. And actually what we're hearing, it's pretty evenly split. Some people saying, yeah, I want to leave with it in my hand. And some saying, no, it's okay. I'll wait until I know it's right. I want to be totally sure that it's correct before I have it. So we're making sure that we're engaging patients and families in these discussions to be sure that the way we then move forward towards implementation makes sense and reflects their priorities. We're then going to be doing some pilot testing in a couple of focused locations where we will have a process that always keeps a human in the loop. So there'll always be a human translator who's reviewing the translations to make sure there aren't serious or significant errors that need to be corrected. And when we do that, we'll then be carefully tracking those instances where there were significant or serious errors and be surveying parents about their experience with the translations and their thoughts about them.
How do you see this type of AI tool being integrated in? Do you think that patients will have the choice that I want to use AI, I don't want to use AI, or will it just be all AI, you know, similar to EHR? I'm sure there's a lot of people that would opt out of using the EHR, but it got systematically integrated everywhere.
That is such a good question. And I am hopeful that the ultimate answer to that is going to be guided by the parent task force that we are putting together to guide the implementation. We are continuing to collect additional survey data from parents, and then we are going to be working with this parent task force to think about how do we implement this in a way that reflects the preferences of patients and families. I love the idea of it being an option. And I also recognize that implementing something with some sort of preference selection from families is complex and has some downsides in terms of sort of fidelity of intervention rollout. So I don't know exactly how this is going to shake out, but I'm really hopeful that we will be able to take families' preferences into consideration. And I know that we're going to be guided in this work by our parent task force.
How do families and especially parents feel about AI being integrated in? Are they very accepting? And then does it differ across different cultures and, you know, even again, you know, different languages, potentially again, for the hesitation of they've had bad interactions with translational tools and so forth?
Yeah, I don't know the answer yet because we have not collected enough survey responses to be able to really have insight into those differences that may exist across language and culture. I imagine there will be differences. You know, thus far, we're hearing a mix of, I'm really excited about this. Sometimes it's hard to get access to human translation. So something that helps us get the information faster is good. And I don't feel sure about this. I'm worried the information won't be correct. So I think we're hearing both. It will be really interesting to look at differences by language and culture. And I think we'll just have to stay tuned to really see the results of that. But I also think it's really important. There may also be regional differences. And so I would also encourage other healthcare systems that are thinking about implementing AI for language access to really think about talking to and involving their patients and families in the work to be sure that it's reflecting what our patients and families actually want rather than what we think they want.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Lyon, thank you so much for this wonderful conversation and this just thoughtfulness in terms of having someone be in this field of trying to have better communication between, you know, provider and patients and the healthcare system, I think is really important. So I'm glad someone like yourself is in it.
Thank you so much.
I am Yulin Hswen, Associate Editor at JAMA and JAMA Plus AI. And I've been speaking with Dr. Casey Lyon about AI enhancing patient-provider communication. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.